Welcome. We'll start with the final chapter for class 11th economics. In this chapter, we'll talk about the comparative developments of India and Pakistan, China. So we are talking about the neighbors of India, and the idea is all of the three nations more or less got independent close by. However, the development pace was slow till 1970s, and post 1970s, we saw the changes that had come up in the three nations, and we would be studying the impacts or the implications in the different regions and the different approaches that have been taken place in India, Pakistan and China. Now, John F. Kennedy laid down a very interesting definition that talked about that geography made us neighbors, history made friends, economic made us partners and necessity made us allies. So this is a kind of very interesting quote to understand how and why we need to have a kind of comparative understanding of India and the developments that have taken place in the neighboring regions. Now, India has been part of the various regional groups. There are other regional groups that are into existence in the world, like you have ASEAN, you have the European Union, you have G8, G20, BRICS and so on. So all these regional groups basically bring together people which are or the countries which are allies, and they try to understand and develop a kind of common mindset on certain parameters. So this has been a kind of breaking ground to understand the developmental parameters. For example, Pakistan took a kind of mixed market economy approach. So this mixed market economy approach brought about both private and government players at a leveling field. So there were different approaches that took place in different parts of the world. India, we say, is world's largest democracy. We are working towards a kind of secular and a kind of liberal constitution that we have. However, in Pakistan, you had a kind of military rule that we can say that's there. And in China, you have a kind of command economy. So all these three regions have different economic or different political outlook, but still there were numerous similarities. So let's first look into the similarities or dive into the similarities first. So China got independence or became the People's Republic of China in 1949. India and Pakistan attained freedom in 1947. Similarly, in India, the first five-year plan was announced in 51-56. Pakistan, you had the first plan that came up as medium development plan in 56. And China announced its first plan in 53. So all of these had their first plans more or less in the close-by duration around 1950s. Then towards the 2013s, if we talk about, Pakistan had the 11th five-year plan, you had the 13th five-year plan in China, and India had the 12th five-year plan. So again, there was a kind of correspondence or similarities in the five-year plans or the medium-term plans or whatever name you can give to those, had a kind of sequence that could be seen. Also, the growth rate and the per capita income in all the three countries was more or less at par. So those were some of the major similarities that were seen in. However, when it comes to the methodology that was adopted, different countries had different methodology. China, you had one party rule that was established. Now, this one party rule talked about economy, enterprise, and land ownership by the individual should be under the government control. Till now, you had the Maoist rule, and later on, from 1958, you had a kind of great leap forward movement, and this campaign led to industrialization. So numerous small industries were established at home. You had numerous industries coming up in the backyard of the people. You have small industries that were more flourishing as compared to one big industry in China during that time. Also in the rural areas, you had the commune system that was collective, the collective cultivated land that was given, and everyone was allowed to keep all the income that was coming from the land after paying certain taxes to the government. During this time, China witnessed a kind of intrusion from Russia. There was also a kind of severe drought that was affecting China. You had the Mao rulers who basically were trying to introduce a kind of cultural revolution in 65, and in 78 you had the first reform movement that started in China. This was mainly in agriculture, trade and investment. So this reform movement talked about bringing in private sectors into play, but these private sectors were allowed to produce certain groups, certain goods. However, there were state-owned enterprises, or what were known as SOEs during that time. They were having a tough competition because of the private sector coming into role. And again, there was dual pricing that was fixed up. This dual pricing talked about kind of farmers and industrial units which were required to buy and sell kind of fixed quantities of inputs and the outputs that were there, based on the price fixation that was done by the government, and the rest that was purchased and sold into the market. So that was a kind of dual pricing that was seen. Again, if we talk about the present scenario in China, you have numerous special economic zones coming up in China. So the economy is slowly and gradually trying to liberalize and move forward. Now, this was one of the parameters that we have talked about. As we move forward, we would talk about the demography and human development indexes in all the three nations as well. Coming on to Pakistan, as we said, we had a mixed economy model. You had private sectors and public sector working together. A regulatory policy framework was there for import substitution based on industrialization. It basically combined the tariff protection for manufacturing along with the direct import controls that were there. So initially it started with Green Revolution. Around 70s you had nationalization of capital good industries that took place. Then there was denationalization and private sector was pushed up. So slowly and gradually around the reform movement that took place in China was 1978, and here around again 1980s you had private sector that came into play. A lot of financial support was coming in from Western nations. The remittances were coming in from the people who are working in Middle East. So two important sources of income for Pakistan was remittance by the workers who were working in Middle East and sending money to Pakistan. The other source of income was the financial support coming in from the Western nations. And finally, in 88, you had the real era of reforms that started in Pakistan. Now, if we talk about the demographic indicators, we say you have, of every 6 person that are present in the world, one is Indian, one is Chinese. That means India and China are the countries which are leading the world in the terms of population. So definitely we have a huge amount of population that's there. If we compare ourselves with Pakistan, we can say only 1/10 of the population resides in Pakistan. So China being the leader, India being the second largest in terms of population, and Pakistan is just 1/10 of India. So now when we are comparing these three nations, the study becomes difficult, because India and China have a huge bunch of population whom they have to feed or whom they have to work around. However, Pakistan has a smaller amount of population that's there. The population growth, on the other hand, is registered highest for Pakistan and lowest for China. So again, the density is very low in China. China, the interesting thing is most of the population is concentrated towards the coastal area. The center area is predominantly dry. As a result, you do not have a kind of cultivated land or a kind of residential pattern that is seen. Most of the economic activity, be it agriculture, be it industries, are confined towards the periphery. Again, China, you have an interesting concept that all these three nations were initially based on agriculture. Slowly and gradually, you had industries and services that got a thrust. In India, you had a sudden shift from agriculture to service sector. However, in China, you had a shift from agriculture to industrial sector or manufacturing sector. So that was again one of the major differences that was there. Around 1970s in China, you had a one-child policy. However, during that time, the sex ratio declined suddenly in China, and this became at such a low level that it became the lowest among all the three nations that we are trying to study. So again, China had a fear that after few years, the amount of elderly population would increase suddenly. So what would happen is they relaxed the one-child policy norm and they made it a kind of two-child policy norm. The fertility rate is again the highest seen in Pakistan. Urbanization is highest in China with 59%, and then you have India at around 33% of the area that is urbanized. when it comes to GDP and the various sectors, we have already talked about how the shift took place from agriculture to industry in terms of China, in the countries we say China moved towards industrialization and manufacturing. However, India and Pakistan directly jumped towards the service sector. So that was one of the major differences. The next is, China is the second largest GDP in terms of purchasing power parity. India's GDP in terms of purchasing power parity is around 7.5 trillion. And Pakistan is very less than India. So it's just 0.89 trillion. China is registering a kind of double digit growth rate. Pakistan was ahead of India in 1980s, but the growth rate declined by 4% because of the political instability and the reforms that brought up that was part of the economic changes in Pakistan during 1988. Physiographic region of China we have already discussed. In India, as we said, India was predominantly an agricultural land. In India, agriculture to GDP is 17% with 50% workforce, while in Pakistan, the agriculture to GDP is 25% with 43% workforce. So still, India has a huge proportion of workforce which is employed in the agricultural industries. China, as we said, has maintained a higher industrial growth rate, is much faster than India and Pakistan in terms of human development index. So Pakistan is slowly and gradually shifting to service sector. Now, a very interesting fact about Pakistan, although it has been behind on many of the parameters, but in terms of people below poverty line and sanitation, it's ahead of India. So India definitely needs to look forward to Pakistan as well in terms of people below poverty line and the issues of sanitation. Neither of these countries were able to work good on maternal mortality rate. China performed best with 27 as MMR. However, in India and Pakistan, it's across 150. That's very, very high. All the three nations have been working on safe drinking water. The proportion of people below the international poverty line in India is largest. So India has a huge amount of people living below poverty line. We talk about liberty indicators, but this does not include the extent of constitutional protection given to the rights of the citizen and the kind of independence of the judiciary and rule of law that's there. So this liberty indicators talks about the democratic participation in the social and the political decision making that's there. The next is the approach that has been taken place. So as we said, the reforms started in China in 78, Pakistan in 88, and India in 1991, which we call as LPG reforms or liberalization, privatization and globalization in India. The idea was laid by Dr. Manmohan Singh during that time. Now we would be discussing the achievements that were made pre-reform and post-reform. It would be a kind of comparative analysis. As we said, till 1970s, the performance was poor, but after that, there was different levels that were achieved. Now in China, there was initially no compulsion that was dictated by World Bank or International Monetary Fund, because that had been with India and Pakistan, because India had borrowed from World Bank and IMF. Under the Mesoist rule, the growth rate was very slow. There was lack of modernization. The economic development was predominantly based on decentralization. So this model could not survive for long. As a result, you had land reforms coming in, collectivization of land that started under the commune system. And then you had the Great Leap movement. All of those brought a kind of thrust in the education sector, healthcare sector. You had a kind of more decentralized planning with focus on small enterprises in long run. And finally, you had reforms that took place at a smaller level rather than one big reform at a massive level. So those were the main things that happened in China. In terms of Pakistan, if we talk about, we see that the reforms led to worsening of the economic indicators in Pakistan. So that was a kind of very interesting finding with Pakistan. Both the countries, India and China, performed comparatively better with economic reforms, but China performed worse with economic indicators after the economic reforms took place. So growth rate of GDP and the sectoral constituents basically declined. The proportion of poor, which was in 1960s around 40%, it declined to 25%, but after reforms it again started to rise. So that brought in kind of that was mainly due to political instability and the issues in the nearby area. The agricultural growth was based on good harvest, and the institutionalization process of technical change basically affected this aspect. You had most of the foreign remittance, as we said, coming in from the workers who were working in the Middle East, and they were sending the money back to Pakistan. Again, Pakistan needs to recover from the economic instability that had taken place, and the major reason was the overdependence on the remittances coming in from the Middle East and the foreign aid that was coming in from the Western nations. Because of that, the slowdown was obvious in Pakistan during that time. India, we say we have nearly 1/4 of the population living below poverty line. We have nearly 70% of the population which is engaged directly or indirectly with agriculture and allied activities. India borrowed huge loans from IMF and World Bank, which led to the balance of payment crisis in India. So we need to build up the foreign exchange, and to build up the foreign exchange, we need to have a kind of good export that should be there. So ultimately, we saw a kind of summary that China succeeded in the market system without losing political commitment. The major reason was it could provide additional social and economic opportunities to the common man. It could provide industries or manufacturing as one of the major ideas. Again, the commune system was highly successful because of the collective ownership of the land. The individuals were allowed to cultivate and they were given the share. They only had to pay taxes in lieu. So those were the factors that ensured that China performed really well, not only in the urban areas but also in the rural areas. So those were some of the ideas that we have seen, how the development changed in the various regions. We will be working around the economics class 12 in the further classes. So stay tuned. Have a great day ahead.